Proverbs chapter 1. Forgot to change this as well. We're pretty busy at the break. This will be part 7 and the last part of looking at to know wisdom and instruction. My intention is not to spend 7 parts on each objective, otherwise we'll be here for quite a while. And so I don't intend on doing that, but this is the first one, and there's a lot of issues compacted in this first objective as far as knowing and wisdom and instruction. And once we got those settled, we'll kind of be able to bring them into the further objectives. But I'm going to go ahead to get us started here reading our passage, Proverbs 1, verses 1 through 6. We'll pray, and then we'll get into our second session here this morning as we move on, dealing with the concept of the fear of the Lord by examining these passages in Paul's epistles. But Proverbs chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. The Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, to know wisdom and instruction, to perceive the words of understanding, to receive the instruction of wisdom, justice, and judgment, and equity, to give subtlety to the simple, to the young man knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and will increase learning, and a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsels, to understand a proverb and the interpretation, the words of the wise and their dark sayings. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for this time that we can gather together and progress along in this part of your word in the book of Proverbs that sets forth a structure and order to what David was going to educate Solomon in, and that we can glean off of in connection with what you, Father, teach your sons and daughters, not only to Israel, as when the Lord Jesus Christ would come and begin to provide the education for them and the Spirit would take over after your Son would ascend into heaven with you, but also that through our apostle, we would receive this kind of information. Although our information is tailor-made for the dispensation of grace in which we live and therefore its purpose unique, the kind of information is what we're learning about here in the book of Proverbs. So, Father, we thank you that we can do these things and we can redeem the time to your honor and glory. It's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Again, the reason why we're taking a look at the issue of the fear of the Lord is coming from the exhortation from David here to Solomon, starting in verse 7. We dealt with that in, again, a lot of these things are just in general right now. And I know that might not be something that you like. I know when I hear pastors and teachers talk about generalities and those type of things, give me the specifics. But we will eventually get in the specifics as we go on. Right now, the purpose is just to deal with these in a very general way. And I've also come to appreciate the necessity of looking at it generally and then building as we go on. But again, the first objective here is to know wisdom and instruction. And we've talked about that in the manner in which we have up to this point. I'm not going to rehash that for time's sake here in our second session. But as David begins now to exhort Solomon in connection with these objectives, the first one again, to know wisdom and instruction, this is the exhortation. And really the exhortation goes from verse 7 all the way down to the end of chapter 1. We're just looking at the first section of it, and that is in verse 7, 8, and 9. And as he begins to do that, he says this in verse 7. He says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction." And what we talked about is to know wisdom and instruction is just begin to become cognizant and aware that our Father has wisdom and instruction for us. And since he has it, that it's exclusive. It's exclusive, it's from him, and therefore, because of that, it's unique, because it comes from him and that wisdom and instruction. And what that ought to produce is a fear. And we talked about last session the positive fear. There's negative and positive fear in regards to some situation, circumstance, some information or cause or whatever it might be that we are confronted with. It can overwhelm us mentally, emotionally, and produce a fear to a negative fear to shrink back from it, or a positive fear to actually move toward it and stand for whatever it is. And the fear that we're dealing with here is not a negative fear like that of Romans 8, verse 15, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but it's a positive fear. It's one of reverence, of awe, of not only who our Father is, but what he has. What's a part of him, his wisdom and instruction for us. And that ought to produce a fear of the Lord. That ought to adjust our attitude that there's no one like him, and therefore what he gives, there's nothing like it. There's nothing like His things, the things of the Spirit. There's nothing like it. And therefore, that's the beginning of knowledge. If you don't have that, then how you're going to, as you go on, when he gets down, look at verse 10, the Father also knows this is going to happen. Verse 10, he says, "My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not." They're going to entice. They're going to entice by, look at verse 11, if they what? If they say, they're going to say some things to you. They're going to entice you. And if you don't have that fear of the Lord, that positive fear that what He has is awesome and is exclusive, and that your attitude is adjusted to Him to hear His instruction, then when these sinners come to entice, the tendency is to consent to them and what they say. And so He knows that, and so that's what He's doing. He's adjusting our attitude to esteem what He has to be the ultimate authority, and that everything else, even though it's going to have an enticement, it's going to lure us and attract us and those type of things, that we're not going to go after it. We're going to rely exclusively upon what our Father has. And that's this concept of the fear of the Lord. And both positive and negative fears are in Romans 8, verse 15. We didn't go to the verse last time, but on your way back over to 2 Corinthians, come with me to Romans 15. Romans 8, verse 15, excuse me. Romans chapter 8 and verse 15. Romans 8, verse 15, he says, "For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we what? Cry. Now again, he's not looking for he's not looking for that. He's looking for an inward appreciation, an overwhelming understanding of what this means. And that's why I'm going into, even though we're going to talk about it generally, you can talk about how much general information we've been going in, and we've been dealing with this in depth. And when you look at it that way, why we're going to the depth that we are to talk about the issue of adoption and talk about what it is, this father-son, father-daughter relationship, so that there is that inner appreciation and overwhelming attitude adjustment to who He is and what He's given us. And also that complete reliance and trust in what He has. The only other time that the expression "Abba Father" is used is Mark's gospel, when the Lord is in the Garden of Gethsemane, and He's about to partake of the cup of that suffering on the cross, and He cries, "Abba Father," and He's relying upon the Father and what He's taught Him of what He's going to do and what it's going to produce and all these things, and He goes and does it. And that's the attitude adjustment that our Father wants to get accomplished with us as well, is what He teaches us, no matter what it's going to cost us, that we participate in it, because the what it yields is glory. Just think about it. Think about what Christ did on that cross, of what it produced. It produced the provision to deal with, to forgive every man of all their sins. It produced the ability to have all those that whom their sins are forgiven, for them to have a relationship with God, their Heavenly Father. It produced that if they participate in that glory. So it can take the lowest of the low and bring them to be glorified with Christ. That's what it did. Those are the things that are in Christ's mind when that cup is before Him. And not my will, but Your will be done. That's what He is starting to get adjusted in us here in Romans 8, verse 15. But both fears are there, even though there's the negatives brought up in utilizing the term, because He's already set it forth in the negative, when He comes along and says, "But," you have the adverse conjunction. And when He gets down, He said, "But ye have received." So one is, you have not received this, the spirit of bondage again to fear. But the other one, you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry. You have the positive fear. You have that emotion. And there is supposed to be emotion behind that, based upon what's given and what it entails and those type of things. And so they're both there. Now look at 2 Corinthians again, chapter 7. We won't deal with the preceding context because we already dealt with that in the first session. But look at chapter 7, verse 1 as we move now forward. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. He says, having therefore these promises, promises of this father, son, and daughter relationship, and being educated by him, and Paul's exhortation for them to be enlarged and not straightened in their bowels, and not to be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, and so on and so on. He says this in verse 1 of chapter 7, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. That's an astounding thing. Perfecting holiness. You and I get to do that. Look at holiness and look how he teaches it and perfect it. Be the extension of God's holiness here on this earth. That's an amazing thing. And it's going to take place in our mind and our spirit and then how we utilize our body. But notice he says, in the fear of the Lord. Because you can only perfect holiness in response to his promises. You get to learn his promises and the riches of his grace and his grace and the abundance of his grace and his love and his great love and his power and the exceeding greatness of his power. And you look at that and those promises and the plethora of his grace that he has toward us, and you look at that and you respond to that as the fear of the Lord, that's a motivating factor to participate in what he is asking us to participate in. In this case, for the Corinthians, to not be unequally yoked together with what he says not to be, and a whole bunch more. Now come with me to another place. Look at Ephesians 5. Look at Ephesians chapter 5. Now there's more places than these. I'm just kind of taking some highlighted passages here. But look at Ephesians chapter 5. Pick it up here in verse... Let's pick it up here in verse 18. So I want you to see how this is connected to the Spirit, to the Holy Spirit. Verse 18, and be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. By the way, that's not being drunken in the Spirit. The issue is, don't be drunk with wine, and if you're filled with the Spirit, you're going to be the opposite of being drunk with wine. You're going to be sober. That's why Paul talks about sobriety so much, and not just about alcohol. Says that in regards to what you think. You go over to Titus chapter 2, and he talks about the elder men, the elderly women. He talks about the young men and the younger women, and the common thread through all of them, how they're supposed to conduct themselves, is soberness. And being filled with the Spirit is the issue of a heightened soberness, and not a being drunken in the Spirit. That's absolutely ridiculous. But verse 19, he says, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So he brings up the Spirit, he brings up the Father, he brings up Christ. And then he says this, verse 21, submitting yourselves one to another in the what? In the fear of God. The fear of God is a legitimate motivating factor for us as members of the body of Christ. It's often neglected because we usually associate it with the negative fear of the law. But the law had its fear and grace has its fear. One's negative, one's positive. One comes along and says, if you don't comply, I'm going to curse you. The other one says, if you don't comply, you're still saved. It's a positive one. It's look at what I've given you and fear it as far as what it is and respond positively to it. And time again, that's what he brings up. And based upon what he's given us and what he wants us to do, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Look at how he deals with this. Come over to chapter 6 and pick it up here in verse 5. He says, servants, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh, with what? Fear and trembling, in singleness of your heart, as unto who? He says, how you conduct yourself, the servant master here is not necessarily slave master relationship. The servant master is more of your, like we think about work today. You have a boss and you're an employee. He that's how he's using it. He says, you go to work, and you don't go to work just to serve your boss, but do it in singleness and heart as unto Christ. And there's that fear issue in there again, that you go to work not in view of how the world goes to work to get a paycheck, just to get some brownie points with their boss. That's how they're going to work well. No, you go to work in light of how your Father has taught you to go to work, and because you fear Him and you want to go and serve Him in your job. We'll talk about that more when we get to Romans 12. But notice he says again, with fear and trembling. That's how we're supposed to. And he says, verse 6, not with eye service, just doing your job when someone's looking. You do your job when someone's not looking. It says, as men pleasers, but as servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. With good will doing service as to the Lord and not to men. Do you know you're supposed to go to work and not serve your boss, but serve God in your job? Knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free. He's talking about the reward. You know you can go to work, and how you go about your work can work towards a reward, the reward for you in the heavenly places. That changes your mind about work. Nothing else like that can do it. Maybe for their reasons, but not like that. Well, look at another one. Look at just the next book over, Philippians chapter 2. And look at verse 12. He brings up that sobriety of thinking again earlier on when he talks about the mind of Christ, and he counted out robbery to be equal with God. He made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of the servant and those type of things, and how that was supposed to affect the relationship of one another with the saints at Philippi. And he says here in verse 12, he says, wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, they weren't just giving eye service to Paul, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation. That's not salvation from the debt and penalty of their sins, nor is that trying to produce evidence of your salvation or maintaining your salvation. The salvation there is the issue when he says, look what he goes on to say. He says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Do all things without murmurings and disputings. What's going on in the local assembly and the disputings and the murmurings that can take place there, he says, you should be able to work out that so that situation is no longer like that. And he says, you do that with fear and trembling, knowing who it is before we're doing this before, God our Heavenly Father. And notice he's going to bring up the issue of sons here too, verse 15, that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation among whom you shine as light in the world, and so on and so on. But again, he says, with fear and trembling there in verse 12. So it is a legitimate motivating factor for us to have some fear. And again, my understanding, that's all too often missing in members of the body of Christ, is that there's not a fervency for the things of God that constrains them because of who is teaching them and what he wants to teach and what he holds out to us and the eternal value of it, that doesn't motivate them to where they look at their life and begin to prioritize accordingly. And it's the very first thing that he wants to get established, your attitude. and it's going to affect everything. Well, let's look at some other places in scriptures and in the scriptures in connection with this. A lot of these come from, let me get my notes here. A lot of these come from the book of Proverbs itself. But before we go there, look at a couple other ones. Come with me to Job 28. You can go to 1 Samuel and 2 Chronicles, and you can see how it's used there in times of war, back in Israel's history. But there's a few other ones I want to check out. Job chapter 28. I gotta get there. I want you to see how it's used here. I'm just gonna start reading verse 1. I'm gonna read the chapter. I know it's 28 verses, but see how it's gonna be used in the last verse. But the whole chapter's setting it up. Okay. He says, "Surely there is a vein for the silver, and a place for gold where they find it. Iron is taken out of the earth, and brass is molten out of the stone. He setteth an end to darkness, and searcheth out all perfection, the stones of darkness and the shadow of death. The flood breaketh out from the inhabitant, even the waters forgotten of the foot. They are dried up, they are gone away from men. As for the earth, out of it cometh bread, and under it is turned up as it were fire. The stones of it are the place of sapphires, and it hath dust of gold. There's a path which no fowl knoweth, and which the vulture's eye hath not seen." If you understand the issue of Job here, there's a lot of things in connection with the patience of Job and what Job goes through, and how the remnant is going to learn from Job about their patience, the patience that they need to go through the day of wrath. And a lot of things about creation come up because God is going to be doing a lot of things with his heaven and earth out here in the day of wrath. And a lot of things that he comes along and says, that God says to Job, is basically telling him, there's things that you don't even know about that you need to know about if you're going to establish a kingdom, and if you're going to get through the day of wrath and those type of things, as he talks about it prophetically. But look at what he brings up here again. Look at verse 8. "And the lion's whelps have not trodden it, nor the fierce lion passed by it." Verse 9. "He putteth forth his hand upon the rock. He overturneth the mountains by the roots. He cutteth out rivers among the rocks, and his eyes seeth every precious thing. He bindeth the floods from overflowing, and the thing that is hid bringeth he forth to light. But where shall wisdom be found? And where is the place of understanding? Man knoweth not the price thereof, neither is it found in the land of the living. The depths say, it is not in me, and the sea saith, it is not with me." He comes along and he says, there's all these things that God knows, and there's a place where the vultures don't know, and this path and all these type of things that he knows of. And he talks about the creative creation and those type of things and what he's going to do to it all. And then he talks about wisdom and understanding. And he says, where is the place of... Do you know there's a place of understanding? An actual place where understanding is. And he says... And he's bringing this up now. He says, "Man knoweth not the price thereof, verse 13, neither is it found in the land of the living. The depth saith, it is not in me." The depth doesn't have the place of understanding. "And the sea saith, it is not with me. It cannot be gotten for gold, neither shall silver be weighed for the price thereof." Who made gold and silver? Well, God did, but you can't get wisdom and understanding by silver and gold. He says, "It cannot be valued with the gold of Ophir, with the precious onks or the sapphire. The gold and the crystal cannot equal it, and the exchange of it shall not be for jewels of fine gold. No mention shall be made of coral or of pearls, for the price of wisdom is above rubies. The topaz of Ethiopia shall not equal it, neither shall it be valued with pure gold." He comes along and says, here's the value of the world, the gold, silver, the rubies. Paul says precious stones. He talks about all these things of how you could value and how you could equal this wisdom and understanding. He says none of them can you utilize to get wisdom and understanding? And you can go anywhere in the world and you can't find the place of understanding. So he continues on, verse 20. Whence then cometh wisdom? And where is the place of understanding? Seeing it is hid from the eyes of all living and kept close, closed from the fowls of the air. Destruction and death say, we have heard the fame thereof with our ears. They don't know where it is. They just had heard the fame of it. God understandeth the way thereof, and he knoweth the place thereof. For he looketh to the ends of the earth and seeth under the whole heaven, to make the weight for the winds, and he weigheth the waters by measure. When he made a decree for the rain and a way for lightning of thunder, then did he see it and declare it. He prepared it, yea, and searched it out. And unto man he said, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is what? Wisdom. And to depart from evil is understanding. Isn't that a fascinating chapter? And he starts off by talking about creation and how he knows that he's done these things with creation. And he utilizes that to validate that he's got the wisdom. But as he does that, one of my favorite verses in all of that is verse 23. God, he brings up all these places that you can't value it and they don't have it. And then he says, verse 23, God understandeth the way thereof, and he knoweth the place thereof. If you want wisdom and understanding, you got to go to him. And that's the only place you can find it. The fear of the Lord is wisdom. It's exclusive to him. If you want it, you got to go to him. Well, that's one passage that brings that. Come with me to some other ones here. Come with me to Psalm 19. Psalm 19. Psalm 19 is beautiful because it goes from how God utilized creation to educate his people for a time, and then there came a time when he brought forth the law, obviously with Moses, and utilized the law to begin to educate his people. And that shift goes from verses 1 down to verse 6 and then verse 7, and we'll pick it up in verse 7. He says, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is what? Is clean, enduring what? Forever. The fear of the Lord can produce some things eternally, in an everlasting nature. And then once he goes into that, he says, the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. That's why we're eventually, in Proverbs, going to get the issue of wisdom, justice, judgment, and equity. But the fear of the Lord is first got to be established. Look at verse 10. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is what? Great reward. The fear of the Lord and the judgments of the Lord, those are the issues that are more desired than gold and fine gold. If you can get, if the Word of God, if you allow it to work effectually in you, to adjust your attitude, to see what He has and that He has it alone, and it's above anything else this world can have. Not only is that something precious at the get-go, but what it's also able to begin to accumulate, the value of it, there's nothing more valuable than it. There's nothing more value than it. And it might seem, you might think it's not that way based upon what the world has and all the technology and all the gadgets you can have and all the things you can do, places you can go. And you think you're not living life very well and you're not living it up and all this stuff. If you have the fear of the Lord, that's better than any of those things. Not only individually, but combined. And boy, when you get there at the judgment seat of Christ, will it be eternally worth it? And if you can keep that in your mind, and when it's not in your mind, renew your mind with it. And that's what prayer is for. Well, that's going to produce some perseverance and some long-suffering, some forbearance, and it's going to produce some patience for you to go through what your Father has in his Word and accumulate what will be put on our account at the judgment seat of Christ. It'll be worth it, trust me. All the things that you can do. There's things I look at, I wish I could have that or do that or get that, or I wish I was at this point in my life and all these type of things. And here I am, a pastor, and I look at it from the world's perspective, obviously, and how I used to think about things. You ask me back in the day, have I ever considered being a pastor? And no offense to you, but a pastor of a small church? No way in the world would I have ever had that for want to go after that in my life. But because of what His Word teaches, nothing special in me, it's His Word. Not special in any of us, any of you, it's His Word working. And you're yielding to it. To have it work in you. And to participate in things. I'm not saying you have to be a pastor in order for it to work. But there's a way in which it's able to work and to produce things that are going to be very, very worth it at the judgment seat of Christ. Even if you just have a little bit of what God's doing, it'll be eternally worth it. Look at another one with me, Psalm 34. Psalm 34. The reason why I said last session that oftentimes when I brought up the issue of athletics and education, some people talk about work ethic. That's essentially what it is. And I remember the nerds in my class. I wish I could go back and be a nerd. But the nerds in the class, right? They just had a great study ethic. They knew how to study. They just could study. They got A's and A's and A's and A's. And I, didn't have great study ethic. But in athletics, you want that coachability and those type of things to be able to listen to your coach and implement the things that he's learning. And oftentimes you'll hear, especially in athletics, you just can't teach that. That's not what the scripture says. When it comes to that fear of the Lord and the issue of value and esteeming those things, all you have to do is spend some time in God's Word and look and give an attendance to what is being said. And maybe just sit down and think about it for a while. And that will start to be produced in you. Because it's just part of who God is. But look what he says here. Let's just pick it up here in verse 11. It says, "Come, ye children, hearken unto me." That's hearken unto him. Listen to him. "Hear. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is he that desireth life and loveth many days, that he may see good? Keep thy tongue from evil and thy lips from speaking guile. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and ears are open unto their cry." But look back again at verse 11. "I will teach you the fear of the Lord." The fear of the Lord can be taught. It can be taught. And it's the very fundamental thing that can keep everything else going on the process. Keep it going. It's so crucial. It's the very first objective, but it's crucial because it's something that's going to perpetuate the process of learning. In fact, Paul brings this up, by the way. Come with me. Hold your hand here in Romans 15. As we go through our edification here at Twin Cities Grace Fellowship, I've taken years to go through this material. But it doesn't have to be that way. Paul says something very unique at the end of Romans 15 that when you look at the process of edification, if if saints are responding to the information, there is an ability to kind of skip through, even though we're not going to skip through it, but there's the skip through being a Corinthian and Galatian and become an Ephesian. The Ephesians, the Thessalonians especially, they just, their pace of maturity was just off the charts. You want to know one of the reasons why? The fear of the Lord. And they had their attitudes adjustment to the information that they took it in. They looked at it, they valued it so much that it was boom. I learned it. I'm going to go take it and apply it to my life. And the Thessalonians are magnified in that sense by the Apostle Paul of how quickly they responded to things. Paul, when he ends Romans 15, this is my understanding, one of the things that this verse goes into. Look at verse 13. Romans 15, verse 13. It says, "Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost." May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing. Part of the fear of the Lord is a component of believing. And he leaves it open for those that have gone through this information, for if you're responding to it, the God of hope to fill you with all joy and peace in believing, and to progress through things on a more in a more quicker pace. And you'll see that if you go over to the Thessalonians again, that's one of their hallmark features, that they took the information of the Apostle Paul and they just ran with it, and it just started operating in them. That's not dictated by, it is God's word, that's first and foremost. But once that's there and that we have it, the next component of that is your response to it. God always has been from Adam looking for our response to him. A willing response and a response of, again, this issue of the fear of the Lord, to have the attitude and I want to go after him, I want to get it. The house of Stephanus, when you go through Corinthians, I think it's at the end of 1 Corinthians. The house of Stephanus, they're characterized as being addicted to the ministry. They were addicts. You think about addicts in the negative sense, think about that same perpetual, habitual thing, and the desire for it, and just the resorting to it, and following after it, and put that in connection with the ministry. That's what the house of Stephanus was. They were addicts. They were addicted to the ministry. And oftentimes we come along, we see that and say, "Oh, good for them, woo! I'm glad there are those people in the church." No, we all should want to be that. Addicted to the ministry and what the ministry does and what it entails and what it is. We want more of the ministry. We want to participate more in the ministry and all the things that come with it and go with it. You know, there's only one place that is the pillar and ground of the truth. It's not the White House. It's not in any other government. It's not in your city councils. It's not in schools. Guess where that pillar and ground? And it's not in all churches. But it's supposed to be the local assemblies. Folks, God puts a premium on the local assembly. There's nowhere else you can go like this. And that ought to produce something in you. And again, I know I'm kind of going off on it, but these are all things that I'm going off into, and what's behind it all is this fear of the Lord concept of how you look at these things and how unique and exclusive they are, and that's supposed to produce in you a zealousness for them. Where were we? We were in Psalms 34. Come with me to Psalm Let's move on a little bit. Come with me to Proverbs. I'm just going to read these off to you. There's a whole host of them in Proverbs, all right? I have them here. I'm going to read them off to you. Proverbs 8, verse 13. The fear of the Lord, now in Proverbs, as he goes on, he just tells them what it is. And that's why I said there's all these things that it can get off to, but it's what's behind it. It's what it is. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride and arrogancy and the evil way and the forward mouth do I hate. Proverbs 9:10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. Proverbs 10:27, the fear of the Lord prolongeth days, for the years of the wicked shall be short. And you ever wonder why one of the things that over there in Ephesians, when he talks about children, obey your parents and the Lord, honor thy father and mother, for the first commandment, given with promise, for if you do it, you'll have long days. One of the issues of that is that if you fear your parents, that fear to honor them, and you fear your parents and what they say, obviously, hopefully Christian parents, but you understand what I'm saying. You know that can prolong your life, physically, can prolong your life. You know, all in today is that the parenting, that what's going on with parenting, and then the children not, whether it's good or bad, but if it's good, the parents, I'm talking about even the unbelievers, if it's good, that child can live longer. Now you start seeing things that the parenting's going down and the children have complete disrespect, no fear of their parents and what they did. I had a huge fear of my dad. And it was probably a negative fear most of the time. But eventually got to be a positive fear. And I cringed. Not of being grounded, but of my father's response. And you know what made me fear him more? I still remember it. I was coming home from a place I shouldn't have been in high school, my senior year, when I started getting in trouble. And I came home. I was supposed to be home at midnight. I left at 11:45, and it takes about 20 minutes to get home. And I was going about 70, 75 miles per hour down the road. We start going down this hill, and there's a deer. I slammed on the brakes, and that deer, it did not move. And I hit that thing, and I totaled my dad's white Ford Ranger. And I remember calling my dad a bloody lip. Airplane came out and all that stuff. And I called my dad. I said, Dad, I crashed your truck. And the first thing he said to me, are you okay? And I said, yes. And he came and picked me up, and we left the truck on the side of the road. And I just cringed at that car ride. And my dad never grounded me. He never gave me a consequence. And that put a fear in me. Not of what's coming, of that he was treating me differently. It shifted from a negative fear to a positive fear. And you know what? My conduct changed at that point. Towards my father, towards his things, towards the things I was going to do. Because of that response, the way he did things like that. And I don't even know why I brought that up, where we're at. But, because I was bringing up parents. And you're starting to see that now. There's no fear of what their parents are going to do. I saw that story with all things were happening at, I think it was Baltimore. I don't remember the place. And there was that child out there, and his mom came. I don't know if you saw those highlights. His mom came, and it started hitting him with the purse. What are you doing out here, riding and throwing rocks? I taught you better and all these things, and they end up going on the Today Show and those type of things. I'm like, all the more power to her. You know, that's they should have a fear of their parents. And at first, it's okay if they're negative, if it's negative, and that'll lead to hopefully some positive fear. But so that they respect their parents and they listen to their parents, and that's again that concept. It's behind everything. The fear of the Lord prolongs long days, but the years of the wicked shall be shortened. Proverbs 14:26, and the fear of the Lord is strong confidence, and his children shall have a place of refuge. Verse 27, the next verse, the fear of the Lord is a fountain of life to depart from the snares of death. Proverbs 15:16, better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure and trouble therewith. Proverbs 15:33, the fear of the Lord is the instruction of wisdom. It's the instruction of wisdom. And before honor is humility. Proverbs 16:6, by mercy and truth iniquity is purged, and by the fear of the Lord men depart from evil. That's a beautiful justification, sanctification passage in connection with the iniquity is purged and then the issue of your walk. The fear of the Lord can produce men to depart from evil. Chapter 19, verse 23, fear of the Lord tendeth to life, and he that hath it shall abide satisfied. He shall not be visited with evil. Now again, there's obviously application to Israel's program. We're just grabbing some principles, and I'm just reading through these. Proverbs 22, verse 4, by humility and the fear of the Lord are riches in honor and life. That's not in this life. That's the life that is to come. Proverbs 23, verse 17, let not thine heart envy sinners, but be thou in the fear of the Lord, listen to this, all the day long. Not just here, there, but all the day long. Come with me to Isaiah chapter 11. We've gone to this passage before. It's one of the passages that help us to get some backing of Proverbs, that Davidic covenant, again, which is crucial to understand. But here you have the prophet Isaiah talking about the Davidic covenant and what that's going to lead to the Lord Jesus Christ. But it goes beyond just the fact of that. It moves into the purpose of him ruling and reigning. But look what it says here. In verse 1, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the what? There are three categories there, by the way. He says, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, and then he's going to describe that. There's two components to each category. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding, that's one. The Spirit of counsel and might, that's two. The Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, that's three. That's another reason why. I don't know where I have it. I have these three. And there's a reason why they're in that order. Because when Christ comes on the scene, he's going to already have developed in him the last one, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. And when he begins to commence his ministry, you're going to see the issue of the spirit of wisdom and understanding. And then he's going to move into the issue of the spirit of counsel and might, especially when he's with the Father in heaven. But all these things, they're all going to be upon him, but he's going to... they take place at different points. But look at verse 3. And shall make him of quick understanding. And the reason why, again, if you see that in verse 2 there, at the end, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. Christ is going to have that. Boy, if Christ had it during his earthly ministry, we ought to have that too. We see Paul had it. Verse 3. And shall make him, this spirit, with all the categories and components of it, shall make him of quick understanding in the what? Fear of the Lord. See, it can provide some quickness. The Word of God is quick and powerful. And its quickness, it can be that in light of our response as well. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. But the very first thing that's mentioned, verse 3, and he shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And that's going to produce the things that you read after that. So again, this fear of the Lord concept is vitally important. This attitude adjustment to the things of God, the exclusivity of it, and what's able to yield. And you'll see it all throughout Paul's epistles. When he brings up the judgment seat of Christ, produce that good, positive, motivating fear. That what you can have is gold, silver, precious stones. instead of the wood, hay, and stubble. I mean, he brings up the issue of running the race, and I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Good positive fear. He pressed towards that. Do you press towards it? And all those issues over war, that's a good positive fear that he's utilizing. Come with me to Isaiah 33. Isaiah 33. I was going to get into chapter 32 to get a little more context. But look at verse 1. This is Isaiah talking to the nation, to the apostate element particularly. He says, "Woe to thee that spoilest, and thou wast not spoiled, and dealest treacherously, and they dealt not treacherously with thee. When thou shalt cease to spoil, thou shalt be spoiled. And when thou shalt make an end to deal treacherously, they shall deal treacherously with thee. O Lord, be gracious unto us. We have waited for thee. Be thou their arm every morning, our salvation also in the time of trouble." So he's talking about out here during the day of wrath. Okay? Prophetically. You know that from verse 3 as well. "At the noise of the tumult, the people fled." The noise of the tumult is the midpoint. When the confederacy of the nations, Psalm 83, the tumultuous ones, gather together with the Antichrist and bring upon the nation of Israel the abomination of desolation, those type of things. And that's going to produce a scattering. "At the noise of the tumult, the people fled. At the lifting up of thyself, the nations were scattered. And your spoils shall be gathered like the gathering of caterpillar, as the running to and fro of locust shall he run upon them. The Lord is exalted, for he dwelleth on high. He hath filled Zion with judgment and righteousness." So he describes what's going to be going on earth. And then he describes what the Lord is doing in the heavenly places and as he's going to come down. Verse 6, "And wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of thy times, and strength of salvation. The fear of the Lord is his" what?
Treasure.
Talking about Christ. Not only can you be taught the fear of the Lord, and we are to have the fear of the Lord, but because of what it can produce, we ought to treasure the attitude adjustment, the fear of the Lord. We ought to treasure that because of what it is and what it can produce and how it produces other things and how it provides us to esteem things to the level in which we ought to treasure the thing itself. And he's talking about that in context as the Lord pours out his wrath and does some things. He's going to have to rely upon his fear of the Lord, the fear of his Father, and those type of things. Turn back to Proverbs with me now. Again, those we can deal with a lot better in their context, but for purpose sake, just trying to show you this fear of the Lord concept is a legitimate thing. And not only in Paul's epistles, but in all the scriptures, there's a negative fear, but there's a positive fear. And as we see the Lord Jesus Christ in connection with his education of his Father, that was one of the very first things that rested upon him. Of the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. In fact, I said go to Proverbs, but come with me and look at Matthew chapter 4. And I want you to see that. And you don't see it, well, you see it in Luke 2 when he is in the temple and the issue of his father's business. You see that there. But from he's 12 to when he's 30, when he commences his earthly ministry, you don't see that being established in him. What you see is it evident when he is 30. When it's been established, now you just see it evident. And look at Matthew 4. Now this is when the Lord is led to the wilderness after he comes on the scene and the Spirit rests upon him. Well, you see, we'll look at that here. those Isaiah 11 and Matthew 3 verses 13 through 17 go hand in hand. Okay, Isaiah 11 verses 1 through, I think it was 7 there, and Matthew 3 verses 13 through 17 go hand in hand. Look at this. Look at verse 13. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But when John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, Suffer it be so now. For thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. And he suffered him. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, or it's going to be upon him, lighting upon him. There it is. Verse 17, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Now look at chapter 4, verse 1. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. So now he's got the Spirit of God upon him, and also lines up with Isaiah 11 issues of what's upon him. One of those things, the fear of the Lord. And so when the devil comes and is going to tempt them, it's going to be the issue of, are you going to listen to him or are you going to listen to your Father? He's out there for 40 days and 40 nights. Verse 2, verse 3. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Same thing that he was doing out there in the garden, he's doing here. But he answered and said, It is written. Notice what he's relying upon, Christ. He relies upon the Word of God. He knows wisdom and instruction. He has that fear of the Lord. And yeah, we can come along and just say, well, obviously, he's Christ, he's God. But as the Son of God, to his Father, he needs to have that fear of the Lord. He needs to listen to his Father, not anyone else. And here, the answer said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. He understood the fear of the Lord, and he was made quick. He was made of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. He understood that he needed to rely upon his Father. And the ends doesn't justify the means, by the way. He's going to tempt him with the kingdom. He's going to tempt him with having rule over all the earth. The very plan and purpose of God to be ruler over all the earth, Satan holds out to him as he's the possessor of earth at this time. And he holds that out to him. If you bow to me, I'll give this all to you. And he knows the end doesn't justify the means. The way my Father taught me to get there is not through you putting me there, me bowing. He knows I got to go through the cross. And so the ends doesn't justify the means, which helps you understand again, just because you're doing works, good works, the end, hey, look at my works, doesn't justify the means. God looks at both. You have that fear of the Lord concept. Come back again now. We'll wrap up here in Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 1. Well, let's wrap up. I believe I have a summary statement here. By knowing wisdom and instruction, the son and daughter of God gains the proper attitude toward the wisdom and instruction. He's not gaining it. He's not receiving it yet. But he is gaining a proper attitude toward the wisdom instruction, an attitude that matches their father's zeal and pleasure for giving it and instructing them in it. You have a zeal for the things of God, his wisdom and instruction that he hasn't started giving you yet. He just says, I have it. You have a zeal for that. Your attitude is just to it. You know that your Father is unique, obviously, our Heavenly Father, that His their wisdom and instruction, therefore, is exclusive. And because of that, because it is holy, what it's able to produce is holy. And what it's able to produce is glorious. And when that's in us, we now can begin to look at these things from His perspective, and begin to see the exclusivity of these things, and that what it's able to produce is holy and glorious. And a lot of that, he's going to do it for us in his word. And that's where to perceive the words of understanding is going to come next. He's going to move from the issue of to know wisdom and instruction, that he exclusively is going to give it, but now he's going to focus upon that glory aspect of it. And he wants us now to understand what the business is all about. And he wants us not just to know it, he wants us to perceive it. In Paul's words, he's going to begin to enlighten the eyes of our understanding. And he does that in Romans. You don't get that terminology until Ephesians, but he starts it in Romans chapter 8 after we leave verse 15. What he begins to do is he begins to open your eyes of your understanding and begin to have you look at something that you can't see, but operate upon it in the realm of things that you do see. And in connection with all that, it's the glory that is to come. And you have the issue of knowing where it's coming from, what it holds out, and then he's going to focus upon what he holds out to us and the purpose of it all. And we are to perceive it. And these things, as you might have come to recognize in verse 2, these two things in verse 2, they're very preliminary. They're just adjusting the attitude and they're setting forth the purpose. It would be like someone in a business, in the pizza business. So our purpose is to make, he come along and as he introduced the new employee, as it were, he would say, well, we're going to train you in this, and then come along and say, the purpose of our business is to make quality pizza, deliver it on time, and be at low prices. And your job is to fit, your fit in that. And before the employee ever actually gets into the job, he tells them the purpose of the business. That's what the words of understanding are, and we'll deal with that. But it's foundational, but it's so instrumental, because when Paul sets forth our purpose in Romans 8 verse 16, which is where he's going to bring up, without using the word mystery, he's going to bring up the mystery. When he brings that up, every piece of wisdom and instruction that we learn later on goes hand in hand with the purpose. It's fascinating. And one of the things he's going to teach us about our purpose, about the creature, in the heavenly places, he's going to call it the creature first, and there's a reason for that. He says it's in the bondage of corruption right now. And how he's going to liberate it is with you and I as members of the body of Christ in this dispensation of grace. But not just being there, but functioning there with the wisdom and instruction that he wants to educate us with. And therefore, every piece of that wisdom and instruction, for instance, Romans 12, verse 3, I beseech you, therefore, when he says there, for every man not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but soberly. Do you know the creature right now, the heavenly places right now, does not think soberly one with another? That's why they're in the bondage of corruption. You can see that here on this earth. Now, our government, but the governments across the world, not just ours, are corrupt. Because they're pride. They're not selfless in their thinking towards one another. And that piece of wisdom and instruction, when we come to gain it, is not just, oh good, this is how you're going, this is a good thing and how to employ in this life, but it's working for a skill for the life that is to come, how to function up there. When he comes along and says, be kindly affectioned one toward another with brotherly love, that's not going on up there. In honor, preferring one another, that's not going on up there. But when we learn that, we're able to take that and we're going to bring that up there to the creature. And so when he sets forth the purpose, if he didn't do that, and if we don't perceive it, well, it's just a bunch of good works, Romans 12. Like I've said, we just look at it as the Ten Commandments. Oh, check, 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 check. But when he sets forth that purpose first, and you view all that wisdom and instruction in light of it, well, now there's a whole bunch more that you're coming to learn about not only the life that now is and what we're supposed to be doing in the local assembly, but how it's preparing us for the life that is to come. You get a glimpse, by the wisdom instruction he gives us, you get a glimpse of what you're going to be doing in all eternity. It's a phenomenal thing. But what he wants us to do, he sets forth those words of understanding first. And we'll talk about that more next week as we begin to introduce it. Again, if this issue of to know wisdom instruction isn't completely settled right now, if I were to talk to you, I wouldn't be fretting over it. Because where this really needs to stick is not necessarily right now, even though right now what we're doing, I hope, is helpful. But where it needs to stick is when we get back to Paul's epistles. And we see how he's setting it forth. That's where it needs to stick. And so we'll, once we get back to Paul's epistles, we'll briefly review this each objective concept when we reach it. And then we'll see how Paul's carrying it through with the doctrine that we're supposed to understand. I'll just leave it at that for right now. We'll close in prayer, and then we'll be dismissed, and we'll pick it up next week. Next week, we'll only have the first session in Proverbs. The second session will be a Q&A from the next question on the list. Father, we thank you for this time to get to your word and to wrap up this issue of to know wisdom and instruction. And Father, I pray, if nothing else, that the saints at least know that what's supposed to go on in connection with this first objective is that the attitude of the son and daughter is to be adjusted toward the information in which you're going to give. And then when we look at that information and that it comes from you, but before we even get the details of it, just the fact that you have wisdom and instruction for us, Paul's going to call it edification as he takes those two concepts and combines them, but just the fact of it, we should look at it, and because it comes from you, it should produce that fear of the Lord, that positive fear in us. And there's nowhere else we can go. There's no other place. The depths don't have it. The sea doesn't have it. Unbelievers don't have it. But where it is found is with you. And as our Father, you have some fascinating things to teach us. Spirit of knowledge and of fear of the Lord, the spirit of wisdom and counsel and might and the wisdom and understanding that through Paul's epistles we know as those that rightly divide the word of truth, that as we learn them can begin to conform us into your son's image and not prepare us to rule and reign on this earth, but prepare us to rule and reign in the heavenly places for all eternity. Not just be there, but participate with you in what you're doing for all eternity. Father, we thank you for this grace that you've provided to us. And again, I pray that at least we see that issue of our attitude being adjusted. And I pray that it wouldn't just be an issue of, I believe God's word and I value God's word, but we would really, through God's word, examine the reins of our innermost being and do this through prayer before you, Father, to examine ourselves if that's really the case. And that will be proved and tested as we go forth and tried, as you tell the Thessalonians, how you try our hearts as we go on, as we actually deal with the wisdom and instruction. But before all that, may we examine ourselves that if we really have that fear of the Lord, and if not, to spend time with your word, especially Romans 6, 7, 8, to where we're at this point, and see that there's nowhere else that we can get the things of the Spirit but by the Spirit. It's not found in the law, it's not found in the world. It's found through the things of the Spirit that are going to lead us through Paul's epistles. And we have to heavily rely and completely and exclusively rely upon that information if we want to please you in our life. And so, Father, we thank you for this information. We thank you that your word provides all this to us. The operations of your word are numerous and what they're able to do. And so we thank you. We thank you for your son, the Lord Jesus Christ, how that he died for our sins, was buried, and rose again. And as always, Father, we pray that if someone's here listening, that they have not trusted that wonderful news, they need to, because they cannot pay for the debt and penalty of their sins in and of themselves. But you sent your son to die for them, to pay for that debt and penalty for them. He commended his love toward them while they're yet sinners. If they believe that wonderful news, this very moment, they'll be forgiven all their sins, past, present, future. They'll be imputed or given your righteousness. They'll be justified unto eternal life, and they will therefore possess the gift of eternal life. May they believe this very moment. And again, Father, we thank you for this time of grace giving. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.